showing very strong, easily the link between the Earth and the galaxy and the origin of the universe. So I start so this the part on the composition of the Earth. And so I decided to start by this paper. So this is a very classic paper from Claude Allègre and co-workers, and it is explaining things very simply. And so it is saying that if you can read it, that the bulk composition of the Earth is modeled or calculated, determined from concentration of major and trace elements, okay, that we selected once, and we'll see how to do that. And to do that, they use elements which are lithophile and elements which are siderophile. Of course, a ratio of two lithophile elements will not be modified by formation of the core. And if you have connection correlation between lithophile to lithophile ratio, which is not modified by the formation of the core, and the siderophile to lithophile ratio, which is modified by the formation of the core, you can determine the concentration of this siderophile element before the formation of the core, and so by difference calculate the composition of the core. This is what I'm going to show. And so at that time, and James I think has shown results perhaps in this week, at that time they predicted that the core would be 7% silicon and 2% sulfur, which is not what is and 4% oxygen, which is not far but not what are the best estimates today, but we will see how this can evolve. So the assumption which are made, and this is in this paper, there are very very strong assumptions which are made. So the first one is that there is the assumption that the Earth, the bulk composition of the Earth, follows the trends, the chemical trends which are shown by chondrites. So there is a parentage between the composition of chondrites and the composition of the Earth. This is a very strong assumption, okay? And you will see that among these chondrites there is a specific class of them which they consider to be the best one. The second assumption is that the mantle is homogeneous, okay? The upper and lower mantle have the same composition, and so they can estimate the composition of the primitive mantle. The primitive upper mantle is the valid for the bulk mantle. They use some constraint from seismology, of course, on the proportion, on the mass fraction of the core, and on the composition of the core. And they say that each of these assumptions can be challenged. We will see why. And what I put in blue is that it is stressed very strongly that the assumption of a chondritic Earth is implicitly or explicitly made by all authors. I think that Mathieu Touboul next week will probably discuss that in very much more detail than me. For trace element, I don't know, samarium, for instance, whether to show you, to discuss what are the arguments for the Earth to be chondritic, for samarium neodymium ratio or not, or these kind of things. And so the approach can be understood, I think, at best from this very, very classic paper. So this is very, very far away. Okay, Yagut and co-worker in 1979, so made in Mainz. And this is showing magnesium to silicon ratio versus aluminium to silicon ratio. And so you have the black dots are composition for peridotites, both enriched and depleted, well, not enriched, but more or less depleted. And these points here, and with these letters that we'll learn in a few slides what they mean, but these are the different kind of chondrites, okay? Unstatite chondrite, H and L chondrite, carbonaceous chondrite, the one which have the composition of the sun are the C1, which are here, okay? And all these C means carbonaceous chondrites, a different class of chondrite. So the idea behind this diagram is that there is some kind of trend for which is shown by the mantle, the upper mantle of the Earth, by these peridotites, more or less depleted. And there is another trend which is shown by the chondrites. And if you make the assumption that the composition of the Earth should be on the chemical trend defined by chondrites, the idea would be that the initial composition of the Earth would be at the intersection between these two trends. Okay, so the trend for the Earth is called is due to fractionation. So this is simply due to partial melting. Aluminium is incompatible during partial melting of the mantle. Magnesium is compatible, stays in olivine. So primitive composition would be with high aluminium to silicon ratio and low magnesium to silicon ratio. So they would be here. And by differentiation, the remaining depleted source will evolve toward this way. For chondrite, this is not the same process. So what we see, which fractionates the element, is not partial melting. It's another process. This is what is called the cosmochemical fractionation. And this is related to something else that we will see in more details in a few slides, which is the fractionation of the element due to their refractory nature. And so if you condense from a gas of solar composition elements, the most refractory silicate will contain more aluminium than silicon because aluminium is more refractory. And there is also a difference between magnesium and silicon, which would explain this kind of trend. Okay, so this is the idea. You try to find the starting composition of the mantle of the Earth from this kind of correlation, and you can see that the pyrolite composition of ringwood is 25% of basalt plus 75% of peridotite is close to this intersection. So this is the idea, okay? And then Allègre and others in their paper, they played the game in this way. For instance, they looked to aluminium, magnesium, silicon, magnesium. So this is the same kind of diagram. They didn't want to make an assumption on the intersection with chondrite. So they decided that the starting composition was the one which was the less depleted for aluminium, magnesium, so the highest one in this correlation here. So from that, they can determine the silicon, magnesium, and aluminium, magnesium ratio. And when they have this ratio, they can go to meteorites and they plot composition of different kind of meteorites. So there are carbonaceous chondrites in black here, and the other chondrites, ordinary chondrites here. They make a very strong assumption, which is perhaps not valid, we will see, which is to use the trend of carbonaceous chondrites, okay, which is this one, so defined by this black dot. You see that the other chondrites do not define the same trend, and then they have determined previously the magnesium to aluminium ratio, and from this ratio they can calculate the iron to aluminium ratio of the bulk Earth before formation of the core. And from that, by mass difference, with what is remaining in the mantle of the Earth, they can calculate how much iron is in the core, for instance. So this is the principle. And from that, they got a composition. So this is the composition, which, so I don't want to spend too much time because we were going to see many other ones. This is not the point of knowing these numbers by heart, it's just to understand the process. So, and you see, you can compare this composition here with pyrolite of ringwood. It is not so far, okay, for major elements. So a refinement of this approach is for instance shown in this. I took that in the book by Anderson, okay, because it's very simple diagrams. So the idea is that if you, for many elements, for many reasons, some people think that Ci would be a better start for the composition of the Earth. As we have seen before, so this diagram by Yagut, Ci are not at the intersection between the geochemical trend and the cosmochemical trend. They are here, okay? And so if the starting composition of the bulk silicate Earth is here, this is different from this intersection. The idea is that perhaps what we see with the geochemical fractionation is what we see in the upper mantle today. So this is reflecting not the primitive differentiation of the Earth, but it could have been modified by a very early differentiation of the Earth. And the idea is that you could perhaps buy, if you have a stage of a magma ocean on the Earth, make a primitive differentiation between upper mantle or source of the upper mantle today and the remaining cumulates which would stay behind, okay? And this is shown in this diagram. So if you start from a composition which is here, okay, and if you extract, you make a magma ocean, you would extract melts and have leave crystals behind, and you would make a composition which would be different from the when the magma ocean is crystallized, which would be the composition of the mantle from which today you make the crust, or you have made during the history of the Earth, extracted the crust. And so this geochemical trend we see in meteorites, in mantle rocks, reflects the differentiation of the Earth, but not the initial differentiation of the Earth, and reflects the differentiation of the Earth from a composition which would be different from the initial composition of the Earth, which would be here. And this, to go from here to here, you could perhaps explain it, okay, by having this early differentiation. So this is one idea. The problem then behind all that is, of course, then if we add another dimension to it, if we add the dimension of isotopes, and this you know very well, but the problem is with oxygen isotopes. So as you know, stable isotopes like the isotopes of oxygen, which has three stable isotopes, 16, 17, 18, are fractionated by chemical reaction, evaporation, any kind of processes, and all these fractionations obey a law which is called the mass fractionation law, which is summarized here. Okay, if you have an exchange of oxygen between two species, XO and YO, you can show that the fractionation of the 17 to 16 ratio is proportional to the fractionation of the 18 to 16 ratio, more or less to the difference of mass between the two. It means that if you go in delta notation, so in per mil unit of the variation of the isotopic ratio, which is written in delta units like that, you can say that you can show that the variation of the delta of 18, which shows the per mil variation of the 18 to 16 ratio, is twice that of the delta 17, which is the per mil variation of the 17 to 16 ratio. This is verified by all terrestrial rocks today. Okay, this is shown in this diagram, delta 17 versus delta 18. The slope is 0.52. You have all kinds of rocks here, sediments, mantle rocks. You have even the seawater, and you have Archean sediments, which is showing that in the past, 3.5, 3.8 billion years ago, it was already the same thing. So this is very strong. And on Earth, we know very few cases where this law is not true. And this is taking place only on the Earth in some kind of reaction, which is a very specific reaction, which is making the ozone in the atmosphere of the Earth. And this has been shown by experiments very long time ago, 1983, by Mark Siemens. And you see these are experiments. You start from, so this is the same diagram, delta 17O versus delta 18O. You start from oxygen, which is here. You make an electric discharge in the oxygen gas, which will produce some ozone and some remaining gas. And you separate this gas after that, and you see that the ozone is here, its isotopic composition is here, and the remaining gas, its isotopic composition is here. And these gases define a slope of 1 and not the slope of 0.52. And so this is known as mass-independent fractionation. This has been shown experimentally. This is taking place on the Earth, and if we measure the isotopic composition of the ozone in the stratosphere, it is very much fractionated. So the same diagram. This is a 0.5 line, which is called the terrestrial fractionation line, TFL, and you see that the ozone is not on this line. It's on a line of slope 1, and then the oxygen within the ozone is mixed by chemical reaction with other species in the atmosphere containing oxygen, and this isotopic anomaly is diluted and is still present at some level in other gases in the atmosphere, but it is produced by the reaction which makes the ozone. So in the Earth, it's very rare. In meteorite, this is general, okay? And this has been discovered in the 70s, and this is the discovery paper. This is the reason why I show it. And this is the 0.5 line. So the Earth is on this line. And these spots are components of meteorites. And you see that they are on a line which is close to slope 1. So in meteorites, this is the rule. Most meteorites show non-mass-dependent oxygen isotopic fractionation. And if we go to chondrites, so the chondrites that we use to determine the composition of the Earth, in this diagram, okay, the Earth is here at plus 5. So the Earth is exactly here, okay? And all the chondrites have different oxygen isotopic composition than the Earth, and they are different by mass-independent, non-mass-dependent fractionation. So there is no way, by any kind of process like melting, crystallization, evaporation, diffusion, anything, to bring back the composition of chondrite to that of the Earth. There it is impossible to, in other words, the oxygen which is in the Earth is not the oxygen which is in chondrite. And this is true for all chondrites except a special class of chondrites, which is enstatite chondrite. And this is this which is in chondrite is also present in differentiated meteorites. You know, chondrites are undifferentiated meteorites, but differentiated meteorites, so samples of small bodies which have melted. And the best example, of course, and in planets, okay, in Mars or the Earth or the Moon, they also show differences, okay? There is no planet or no differentiated planetesimal which has an oxygen isotopic composition like the Earth, which is here, they're all different. You see that on differentiated objects, they all show the fact that they are geologically active, that there are fractionation taking place in them, so they show a range of variation which is parallel to the mass fractionation line because they have melting going on, crystallization going on, so they are fractionating isotopes along a line of slope 1.5 by normal mass-dependent processes, but their initial composition is different from that of the Earth. By the way, this is one of the best proof that magma ocean and global melting took place on small bodies, because this is the only way to start from a range of composition like that. So this is, for instance, a class of chondrite here. And you see it's showing a very large range of oxygen isotopic composition, non-mass dependent. But when you go to a differentiated object, I don't know, this one, there is no range anymore in non-mass dependent isotopic composition. Okay, it is only a single one, but it is only fractionated by mass dependent. So the only way to homogenize the oxygen isotopic composition is by global melting. And this is the way that you can demonstrate that a meteorite coming from the Mars is not terrestrial, okay, because it has a different oxygen isotopic composition from the Earth. That's it. And so if we go back to this diagram, the problem then is that, of course, if we look to the intersection between the geochemical trend and the cosmochemical fractionation, trying to make the Earth with meteorites, of course, the only one which have an isotopic composition close similar to the Earth are these ones, okay? They are the ones, the enstatic chondrite, which are very far away from the intersection. So you see immediately that there is a problem. So there are different ways to solve this problem. One way to solve it is to say that if the initial composition of the mantle was here, we have to transform this composition here to this composition. One way to do it, we have seen before that we could imagine to go from this composition by the fractionation taking place during magma ocean at the beginning of the Earth. But if we want to go from here to here, we have to lose a lot of silicon from this composition. The way to do it is to put silicon in the core. So if we put silicon in the core, if we do this fractionation, and we could start from this initial composition for the bulk Earth, and then we would put silicon in the core during the core formation and have the mantle which would go from here to here. So this is the idea of Marc Javoy. So this is another kind of model. And so the idea is that contrary to what I have shown before, here there is no assumption at the beginning for an homogeneous mantle. The only thing is that the idea is to start from isotopic constraints, so starting from the composition which is correct for the oxygen isotopic composition. So they start from this specific chondritic composition imposed by isotopes, and then they simulate core formation, taking partitioning coefficient at different temperature, different pressure, trying to improve that, and calculate what the composition of the core would be and what the composition of the remaining mantle would be. And then at the end, they compare this composition with that of the upper mantle today, and they find that it is different. And then they come to the idea that the mantle is layered and that there is a lower mantle which has a different isotopic composition than the upper mantle. And this is the kind of composition they can get, okay? And it is better shown in this diagram. So this is another paper by Javois showing the result of his model, of this assumption, compared to all the other ones. So all these ones are not using unstatite chondrite, but are using different kind of argument, like I have shown before. And they are more or less giving similar results, okay? But you see, if you go to this other model, it's very different for magnesium. So the earth contains much less magnesium, very different for iron. There is much more iron, and very different for silicon, okay? There is more silicon also at the beginning. So this, you know, it's a real question, and with time, it has become more and more obvious that the difference in isotopic composition was a very strong constraint, okay? And in fact, it's not only oxygen isotopes. All isotopes we can measure now show that the Earth is close in isotopic composition with unstatite chondrite. And here I show other kind of isotopic composition. So you don't need to try to understand in details what they mean, but okay, this is also non-mass dependent isotopic variation, not for oxygen, but for other elements. So oxygen is shown here. So capital delta 17O, which is shown here, is the deviation from mass dependent fractionation. So the Earth, by definition, is at zero, okay, and unstatite chondrite is at zero. They are on the terrestrial fractionation line. You see that if you look to as we have seen before, okay, Mars is slightly different from the Earth. Only unstatite chondrites are like the Earth. Other chondrites are different. But what is very important to see here is that this systematic is also the same for chromium isotopic anomaly, titanium isotopic anomaly. And in fact, you see that the chondrites and planets, terrestrial planets in the solar system, belong to two families, two groups of objects. Okay, and this is more and more admitted now. And one group of objects is the terrestrial planets, okay, Mars, the Earth, Moon, satellite of the Earth, unstatite chondrite, ordinary chondrite, we will see what they mean. Some differentiated objects like angrites, their parent body is perhaps Vesta, not Vesta for angrites, sorry. Vesta is for these ones. And you see that on the other side, you have all the carbonaceous chondrites. So the one which are used to determine in the classically the composition of the Earth, they are in fact completely different, okay? And this dichotomy in the isotopic composition in the solar system is now very clear. And you can play the game to say, okay, we, for instance, I can make the isotopic composition of the Earth by making the Earth from this and this, and then I can calculate simply by mass balance how much carbonaceous chondrites, how much unstatite chondrites I need, what is the mix of the two to make the Earth so that at the end the isotopic composition is correct. And of course, because you have to fulfill the constraints from different isotopic systems, oxygen, chromium, titanium, you have different equations, so you can make this calculation different times. Of course, the concentration of titanium, chromium is not the same in all these meteorites, so this gives you independence equation, and so you can solve that and find with an error the best proportion of the two components, and this would give something like, okay, you need around 25% of carbonaceous chondrite and 75% of non-carbonaceous chondrite to make the Earth. And the proportion for Mars are slightly different. So this is one approach, okay? And this has been verified since then by other isotopic systems, so not only oxygen, chromium, titanium, but you see, this is also the case for strontium, okay? The unstatite chondrite are here, okay? They are the only ones to have the strontium isotopic composition of the Earth. They have also the good nickel isotopic anomaly. They have also the good molybdenum isotopic anomaly, and so on. And so this has been reworked several times, and these are the best today adjustment of parameters using unstatified chondrite as the starting composition of the earth to make the earth. And this is the last paper by the using the approach of Marc Javoie. So in this case, you assume that the earth is made with unstatified chondrite. You could also play the game, okay, to make the earth by mixing different kind of chondrites to at the end make the composition of the earth correct. This begins to be a kind of an exercise, okay, but which is not related anymore to any kind of physics, okay, so it is not very clear what the good approach is. And now the last dimension we need to have in the using chondrite to determine the composition of the earth is the dimension of we have just considered now the fact that an element is siderophile or lithophile. We have now to consider whether an element is refractory or volatile. So what does it mean? So this is defined from this kind of diagram, okay, which is in fact showing at equilibrium thermodynamic calculation, which show what would be the composition of a mineral condensed at equilibrium with a gas of solar composition. So in that case, you imagine that the chondritic composition is that of the gas, that this gas is at very high temperature. We'll see later on why it could be like that. So let's say 2000 K, and then you cool this gas. And by cooling this gas, you will condense minerals. The first to condense will be refractory minerals like corundum, L2O3, hibonite, and other ones. And this is shown in this diagram. This is temperature, and this is the fraction of the elements which are condensed. Okay. At the end, you will condense 100% of the elements. So at the end, at the pressure of the solar system, the gas of the solar system, 10⁻⁴ atmosphere, you will condense water at -120 degrees, okay? But at 1600 K, you will condense corundum. So you can, and you see that the major mineral that you will condense refractory minerals first. They will amount for 10% of all the chemical elements. When you are here, okay, you have condensed all the calcium, all the aluminium, all these elements, they are in minerals, they are not in the gas anymore. And then you continue to condense magnesium, iron, in the form of olivine, metal, pyroxene. This can be made in a very small detail, so this is the same kind of diagram, temperature, and here it's function of pressure. Of course, this phase diagram depends on the pressure. So the canonic pressure, the normal pressure of the solar nebula is 10⁻⁴, so it is in the middle here. You see that the effect of pressure, varying slightly the pressure, has a very strong effect on this calculation. For instance, something very important to see is the difference between the red dash curve here and the black dash curve here. The black dash curve is showing the condensation of metal. Above this curve, metal is in the gas. Below this curve, metal, iron, is condensed as pure iron metal. You see that below this pressure, the crossover here, so this crossover here is for the condensation of forsterite, Mg2SiO4. And so below this pressure here, forsterite condenses first, and iron metal condenses after. Above this pressure, you will condense directly iron metal before you will condense forsterite. This is a very strong change. In this diagram, you can see also that you need, you can condense. So this is calculated, at, okay, at various pressure. Okay, so I will see, I wanted to show that in the next diagram. Of course, you can stabilize, and you see probably it here. It's very difficult to see, it's at the limit. So you can stabilize also liquids, okay? In this diagram, you condense only solids. But if you increase the pressure of the gas, you would stabilize liquid at equilibrium with the gas. the fields of liquids are shown here, and this in that case, it is this calculation is made for a higher pressure, so this is made at 10 minus 3 bar. How do you make a pressure in the gas which is higher than the normal pressure of 10 minus 4? This is the way to do it, is to vaporize some dust. In the nebula, you have dust and gas. The standard condition has that the amount are such that the amount of dust is such that the pressure of the gas is 10 minus 4. If you vaporize part of this dust, you will put more elements in the, you will increase the pressure of the gas and you can go to higher pressure, and in that case you can condense directly liquids. So this is the principle of the condensation, and at equilibrium you will condense refractory mineral, and then you will calculate at a lower temperature what is the new what are the new equilibrium conditions between these minerals and the gas. And of course when you do that, of course if you have condensed calcium and aluminum rich phase, you change the composition of the gas, so you make this calculation by in a closed system in which you start from a gas of solar composition, you remove minerals depending on their condensation temperature, you change the composition of the gas, and then you re-equilibrate at a lower temperature this new gas with these minerals, and then these minerals react with this new gas and produce new minerals. This is schematized here, okay, and you can see that at a given temperature, you would predict that at equilibrium with the initial gas of chondritic composition, you would have this mineralogy. And of course, different minerals have different condensation temperature. And from that, you define if an element is refractory or volatile. Okay, an element which is refractory means that this element will be. Tu vas faire la police. An element which is refractory means that this element will be removed from the gas very early because condensed in a very refractory phase. So for instance, calcium and aluminum are refractory because they will disappear from the gas by condensation of ebonite and corundum. And so if you go back to the paper of Loders, you will see that you have for each element, you have a temperature of condensation. Of course, I want to stress that this is an exercise, okay? This temperature of condensation depends on the mineral you consider for the condensation of the element. For instance, for oxygen, if you consider that oxygen is condensing in ebonite, okay, oxygen is the most refractory of all elements. But if you consider that oxygen is condensing in ice, oxygen is very volatile. Of course, because of the amount of oxygen in the gas, to begin with, so it's in the form of CO in the solar gas. You don't have enough calcium and aluminum to condense all the oxygen, so you will condense part of oxygen as ebonite, but you will also have at the end enough oxygen to make water and to get rid of all the oxygen which is in the gas. And so when you have that, this is the last dimension. I will stop here, the composition of the Earth from chondrite. And this is a diagram that you have seen many times, probably, that you will see probably in more details discussed by Mathieu Touboul. But it is combining the information from lithophile, siderophile, volatile, and refractory. And so you see, this is the composition of the Earth normalized to carbonaceous chondrite and to magnesium. So this is ratio of elements. So this is, I don't know, aluminum to magnesium ratio, and you see in blue here, so you have the elements that we have discussed, silicon, magnesium, aluminium, which are lithophile and moderately and refractory. So this is the condensation temperature here. Refractory elements are on the right, volatile elements are on the left. You see for the elements which are lithophile, there is in the Earth a depletion relative to chondrite. If they would have the same composition as chondrite, there would be horizontal line here at one. But so there is a depletion of volatile elements. So the Earth is depleted in volatile elements. And also then if you look to siderophile, okay, you have all the discussion that you have on for siderophile elements. For some of them, you see very clearly the effect of the core. You see in details, I will not discuss that, but you can see the lead veneer and so on. And you see the interplay between fractionation due to formation of the core and fractionation due to the fact that there is the Earth has either lost some volatile element or was made from material which was already depleted in volatile elements. I will not discuss all that, of course. So I will finish. So the end of the last part of this morning is on. So this is not good. I don't know why. So this is very simple things on chondrites. So I have so that it's very clear in the mind of everybody what chondrites are. So the classification of so chondrites are a special kind of meteorite. The classification of meteorite is very simple. In fact, you can simply divide meteorites between magmatic rocks and sediments. This is a way to see it. Okay. And the sediments are the primitive meteorites. So it's slightly counterintuitive. Okay. The rocks which are primitive are the sediments. The rocks which are differentiated are the magmatic rocks. And so the chondrites, which I will explain this picture later on, are here, okay? And chondrites can be divided based on their composition on different class and based on the isotopic composition also. So carbonaceous chondrites, only three classes are important to remember: carbonaceous chondrite, ordinary chondrite, and unstatite chondrite. And the differentiated meteorites are either iron meteorites, pure iron, which are probably the core of small planets, which were differentiated. But we have seen that you can condense directly from the gas at special pressure iron nickel metal. Okay, so some iron metal nickel is also direct condensate from the gas. You have stony iron meteorites. Okay, so perhaps the contact between the mantle and the core of a small planet, or metallic iron which has been impacted by silicates and mixed silicates into metal. There are different options. And you have differentiated rocks, so the crust of small planets, okay, which are real basalts and so on, except that they don't have the oxygen isotopic composition of the Earth. They are coming from somewhere else. So all this we don't care today. Okay, we just concentrate on this part. And this is the classification of meteorites. And this classification, of course, can be revised in different ways. Okay, it depends what is the criteria you take for the classification. What I've shown you is this one here. But if you go to the diagram I've shown you before, showing that in fact there was a dichotomy in the composition of meteorite based on oxygen isotopes, you could also make a classification which would be between carbonaceous, so which have a special kind of isotopic anomaly. If you remember this diagram showing oxygen versus chromium isotopic anomaly, or oxygen versus titanium isotopic anomaly, and non-carbonaceous ones, so the Earth would be in this group, okay? And the unstatite chondrite would be here, ordinary chondrite also, but carbonaceous chondrite would be here, okay? So this is a different way. So why are these meteorites primitive? So if I go back to this thin section of a chondrite, so this is a thin section seen in transmitted light. So they are called chondrite because they contain this sphere, which are called chondrules, okay, which are made of pyroxene and olivine crystals and glass, okay, in between. So the idea is that they have been melted to high temperature and they have been quenched, so that they had no time to crystallize totally, and you still have glass in them. This object of different size and different composition, you see here this texture here of a chondrule, probably which has been melted to high temperature with no germ for crystal anymore, and which has been quenched very rapidly to make this texture. This is a different texture with phenocryst in it. Probably it was not heated to the same temperature, so that by cooling, big crystal could develop. And all these high temperature phases are embedded into a matrix, which is the black stuff here, which is made of low temperature mineral, like clay minerals, carbonates, and everything. This is the glue of the chondrules. And of course, this is primitive in composition, because the fact that you have high temperature phases with low temperature phases is completely unstable. If you heat this to 200 or 300 degrees, immediately you will have diffusion and reaction between these two phases, and this structure will disappear. So this is the reason why it is primitive. The other reason, of course, is the edge. And if you look to the most simple technique, which is rubidium strontium dating, so these are very old data. The age of all this meteorite is 4.56 billion years. So they are very old. Alors, we will see tomorrow that in fact, if you look into details, they are not the oldest one, and that because they are made of components which have different origins, in fact, these components have different edges, and the edge of a chondrite determined by the rubidium strontium method, like here, doesn't mean anything, in fact. It's just a mixture. These chondrites also contain, in addition to chondrules, they contain refractory grains. This is shown here. Okay, this is Allende, a very well-known chondrite, a CV3 chondrite. This is the melting crust at the surface of it, showing that it has crossed the atmosphere of the Earth. And this white stuff here is an inclusion. And you can see here on a thin section, so this is colors showing the composition. So red is magnesium, green is calcium, and blue is aluminium. And so it's very clear that here you have an object which does not contain much magnesium and which contains calcium and aluminium. So it is made of oxide and silicates of calcium and aluminium. It is a refractory, we call that a refractory inclusion. And if we go back to the condensation sequence, this is another way to show the condensation sequence, starting from high temperature here and cooling the gas and making the mineral. So you see that you start from here at high temperature, you will condense refractory phases and you will condense corundum, ebonite, perovskite, and so on, spinel. And these are the minerals which are in these inclusions, okay? If you take this inclusion, it contains this kind of minerals, or if you take this bulk composition, it is a composition which corresponds to somewhere here, okay, a mix of these different minerals. These different minerals exist also as separate minerals in chondrites, okay? This is a picture of them, okay, that you can find as small grains in meteorite. And if you date these minerals, if you date such a calcium-aluminium-rich inclusion, they are the oldest known object that you can date in meteorites. The best precision can be achieved by the uranium-lead radioactive systems. This is shown here, so I don't want to. I can explain, of course, if you have questions, no problem. But I don't want to explain in too much detail. So you have different ways to show it. But if you this gives you, for instance, in this diagram, the edge is given by the 2.7 to 2.6 ratio when there is no common lead in it, so it's here, and it's giving an edge of which is very easy to remember, which is 4.567 billion years. Chondrules that I have shown before, different kind of texture for chondrules, as I have said. From their composition, you can make experiments and try to melt these chondrules to see at what temperature they melt. This is shown here for their depending on their composition. The liquidus that you can determine experimentally range in this temperature, and here are the different experiments, and you can melt such a composition and then try to quench it, and you depending on the composition, it will or not. It will, during crystallization, cooling, make different textures that are shown here. And you see the idea of this diagram is that you can, by this experiment, determine for a given type of chondrule. These are the real composition of chondrules, all these spots here. And from this kind of experiment, for a given composition, you can determine at what temperature it was melted. And you see that it was melted at very high temperature. So this, and because they were quenched, the idea is that they were melted and cooled in the gas, in the vacuum, in the 10⁻⁴ pressure of the solar system, that's the reason why they quench. And then when you make chondrites, by agglomerating these chondrules together, by accretion, this is in some way, even if not the same, it's not the same physics to make a planet, okay, but this gives you a feeling of what accretion is, okay? To try to completely understand the classification of chondrite, okay, I just want to, for it is a very low level, okay, talk today, but it is just to give you the reason for the names, okay? So the reasons of the name of H, L, L, L is coming from this diagram, okay? The observation that in meteorites, iron, in chondrites, iron is either oxidized or reduced. This is very old, okay, this is the prior, it's dating from 1952. And this is the original diagram showing the concentration of iron oxidized as iron oxide and the concentration of iron metal reduced. And the idea was that the iron was either reduced or oxidized. This was the reason of this kind of correlation. And that in meteor in chondrites, the observation was that there were two trends, okay? One trend with more iron here, more iron rich, and one trend which with low iron. So this is high in iron, so this is the reason of the H, high iron. And this trend is low iron, this is the reason of the L, okay? And this is a more recent version of the same diagram in which, in addition to looking to pure iron and iron oxide, you look also to the iron in the form of sulfide added to iron metal because it is reduced too. And you see that you have the meteorites, the carbonaceous meteorites are oxidized, the iron is oxidized, the anstatite chondrites are reduced, and these EH are because they are high in iron, and the EL are because they are low in iron. And then you have the ordinary chondrite, the L, which are low in iron, the LL, which are extremely low in iron, okay? And this is the reason, and the H, which are high in iron, this is the reason of these letters. And so chondrites can be recognized like that. Chondrites have different chemical composition. So if you take different kind of trace element, okay, you can play this game without understanding anything, okay? You just like collecting butterfly, okay? You make different potatoes with the composition of different chondrites and you find that you have different potatoes, okay? And these different potatoes correspond to different objects and they correspond to the letters, they define the letters we have seen. And if you go within one of this group, okay? So I don't know the next one, who is it? Which one is this? I don't know which one it is, but let's say, for instance, we go to L chondrite, okay? Within L chondrite, the observation is that, of course, the chondrules in the chondrites, the chondrules are made with olivine pyroxene. But when you look to the composition of the olivine and the pyroxene, you see that there is a change. Some are very heterogeneous and some are very homogeneous. And the idea, when you look into details, you see also that the texture is changing. In this one, you see very clearly the chondrules, very well defined. And this is one, the chondrules disappear. And the idea is that what you are seeing here is metamorphism. And so the object starts very heterogeneously due to the fact that during the condensation sequence, you can condense first forsterite, and then you will condense metal, and then metal will dissolve in the forsterite and make iron-rich olivine, and you will produce a range of composition for silicates, which is shown here. And if after that this object is heated in some way, undergoes metamorphism, you will homogenize the magnesium to iron ratio, and you will come here. And so from that you can define different type which correspond to successive increasing metamorphism. And so the classification of chondrite, all the strange names and numbers that you have seen are due to that, okay? It's a table with two criteria, the chemical composition which define the letters, okay? So the very low in iron, the low in iron, the high in iron for the carbonaceous, for the ordinary chondrite and so on. And then the intensity of metamorphism. And so this is slightly strange. You can recognize two types of metamorphism. Thermal metamorphism, as I've shown before, which will go from 3 to 6. And aqueous alteration, which would go from 3 to 1, okay? And you define a table with box everywhere. And these are the meteorites we know on Earth. So for instance, we have never found, L chondrite, which would be L2 or L1. There is no aqueously altered L chondrite. This does not exist at the moment. So this is the definition of all these meteorites, okay? The name of these chondrites. And this is just for you, you will have it, okay? So you can find that in books, okay? This is the number of finds for each kind of chondrites. So, you know, some of them are very, there are very few objects which correspond to that. Others are very well populated. And so this is the reason why cosmochemists are excited when there is a new fall, okay, because nobody knows whether there will be an object which will fall, which will be here, okay? So this would be very interesting, perhaps. This is? So after that, you could, for if you consider that here you have a statistically significant sampling, it means something on the parent body. And perhaps it means that such an object here does not exist. And then you have to, we can see, we will see perhaps after, part of the answer, why such an object exists, okay? For instance, if the parent body of some kind of chondrite is differentiated or undergoing differentiation, it's at higher temperature, it's undergoing metamorphism at high temperature, and so there will be no one or two type of metamorphism on it. Carbonaceous chondrites are much less numerous than ordinary chondrites, okay? This is not really understood. Perhaps it means that their and we will see their parent body. There are many parent bodies that could provide chondrites, carbonaceous chondrites. But carbonaceous chondrites, because of their texture, are fragile. So probably they are destroyed, and there is no much fragment of carbonaceous chondrites which fall on the earth. And then you can these different kind of chondrites have different specificity. For instance, the proportion of chondrules in them is very strong, okay? It's very different. Ordinary chondrites are very rich in chondrules. They are made up to 80% of chondrules. So they are mostly, if you determine the composition of chondrules, you determine the bulk composition of the chondrite, nearly. Other ones have lower carbonaceous chondrites, are varying and lower proportion of chondrites. And when I said to you that C1 chondrites are not really chondrites, C1 chondrite, and specifically the most famous one, which is Orgueil, which fall in close to Montauban in 1880 something. You see, C1 has no chondrule, okay? So it has a chondritic composition, but it has no chondrule. So it is called a chondrite, but it is a chondrite with no chondrule. So it's a very special one. Probably it's a piece of a comet, okay? And so you can see different also. Their proportion of refractory inclusion is very different. So the carbonaceous chondrites are the ones which are refractory, very rich in refractory inclusion. The other ones are much less rich in refractory inclusion. There, and then their composition, the proportion of metal is different also. And this is the explanation in some way, or this is the result, as you want, of the fact that they have different chemical composition. And this is shown, this is also a very classical diagram which shows that you have chemical variation in the chemical composition of chondrites. So when you say the earth is chondritic, okay, you say the earth is chondritic, but you see this is the range of composition you have in chondrites. So the elements here are classified by their, I think, increasing volatility. So from refractory aluminium to sodium, which is very volatile. One here is the composition of C1 chondrite. You see that the carbonaceous chondrite above are enriched in refractory elements, that all chondrites are depleted in volatile element compared to C1, which is again the composition of the sun by some magic. And you see that ordinary chondrite and unstatite chondrite are depleted in refractory elements. The reason for that is not clear. Tomorrow I will show you one explanation that we found recently, but this reflects also in the mineralogy, okay? Ordinary and unstatite chondrite have much less refractory inclusion in them, okay? So you can say that perhaps the fact this difference in composition, excuse me, is due to the fact that when you form carbonaceous chondrite, you added more refractory material in them. Okay. And this also is very clear. For instance, if you go to carbonaceous chondrite, so let's say CV, for instance, which are the square, the white square here, if you plot only CV on this diagram. This is shown here to be more clear, okay? And you see that the abundance is controlled at first order by the volatility, by the condensation temperature. Here, different plot, different elements. The color code shows whether they are siderophile, lithophile, or chalcophile. Except for the extremely siderophile one, rhenium, iridium, okay? In fact, you don't care whether they are siderophile or lithophile. What you care on is their condensation temperature. This is what determines their abundance, control their abundance in the meteorite. So this is condensation, which is a major process. So just 5 minutes to go further on very general things on chondrites. Where do they come from? For what? Of course, yes. Of course, yes, this is due to condensation. So you will see tomorrow, the explanation we have now is the fact that when they form in regions where there was more refractory minerals compared to less refractory minerals. So this reflects, in fact, the fraction of the distribution very early in the solar system of the dust and the proportion and how refractory dust was distributed relative to less refractory dust. And some meteorites form in regions which was enriched in refractory dust, okay, and some meteorites form in regions depleted in refractory dust. You will see tomorrow that how by simulating the formation of the solar system, so this is, yeah. And this is very counterintuitive because you know you will see tomorrow that the carbonaceous chondrites, which are enriched in refractory elements, which contain the refractory inclusions, which contain all the high temperature minerals, are the ones probably which form very far away from the sun in very cold regions. Okay, and we'll explain that. So, where do they come from? For some of them, you can observe the trajectory in the atmosphere of the Earth, and then you can calculate back the whole trajectory. You see that the trajectory is expanding within a region between Mars and Jupiter, where there is the asteroidal belt. Okay, if you look at this very old diagram, which shows the ordering of planets in log unit, not the ordering of the planets, okay, from the Sun versus their mean distance to the Sun in astronomical unit. One astronomical unit is the distance between the Earth and the Sun, 150 million kilometers. You see that in fact this has never been explained. Okay, it is probably some it is very strange, but planets are ordered in regular way. Okay, if you plot that in log unit. Okay. If you plot the distance in log unit, except that there is something lacking between Mars and Jupiter. In old books, this is taken as an argument to say that there was a planet there, but that this planet has been destroyed to produce the asteroids. And from recent, more recent astrophysical simulation, it's very clear that this is not the reason. The reason is that Jupiter, giant gaseous planet, was the first to form in the solar system. It nearly reached the mass of a white dwarf, so it was not enough to be a star, of course, but its mass perturbed the orbits of objects around and in fact prevented the accretion of a planet close to it, and that's the reason why we have the asteroids close to Jupiter, which in fact we are very lucky because they are fossils of the formation of the solar system. It's a place where by chance in some way this small object could not accrete together to form a bigger planet, and if they would have do so, they would have be heated and differentiate and would have lost their initial composition. So these are the asteroids, okay, that you can see, some of them. They have many craters at their surface because they are undergoing collisions with other ones. This is how meteorites are produced, by collision between them. The fragments then are change orbits and go toward the Sun. Some of them going to the Sun stop on the Earth. Recently, so we know these objects by the spectroscopy of their surface. So we can have some, by calibrating that, we have some weak indication on their composition. We have more, and we can pair this object with some meteorites, with some chondrites. Recently, there was a mission going there, bringing back some grains, okay, that you can see here, and we can verify that the idea we have on the composition of these asteroids was correct, and that one of these asteroids, okay, this one which was sampled, was LL4 chondrite. And so you can do the spectroscopy, reflectance spectroscopy of this object, okay. So I have never been very convinced by this kind of things, but okay, it is there. So you can see that they are different in some way, weak differences between them. Then you can calibrate that in the laboratory on minerals, and you can pair this spectra with spectra you get on the proportion of different minerals, and then you can say, for instance, that the C asteroid, okay, so the C spectra, like this one, correspond to carbonaceous chondrite. The E1 correspond to unstatite chondrite. Then it's not so simple for the other one, because S correspond to ordinary chondrite. So like that. These planetesimals are big, okay, their diameter, most of them are 50 kilometer diameters, they go up to several hundred kilometers. The biggest of them is Ceres, which is 900 kilometers in diameter, and their distribution between Mars and Jupiter is not random. So this is showing their distribution, and you see that there are some peaks in the distribution, some distance where there is nothing, okay? And this is understood as, in fact, showing this is called as depletion, okay, in the distribution of these asteroids. In fact, some of this location here are location where an orbit is not stable, okay, the orbit is not circular, is becoming elliptic because of the interplay between the attraction of the Sun and the attraction of Jupiter, okay. When an object is here, the Sun is here, Jupiter is here, it is attracting it, okay, the two gravities sum. And when it's the contrary, when Jupiter is here and the Sun is here, it is attracting the object here, so the object has a more elliptic orbit, and if the orbit is elliptic, it has more chances to encounter another one and to have a collision and to disappear. So this is the reason of these voids in the distribution of asteroids. There is no reason that it is like that. It should have been continuous, okay, when they form. Very recent studies shown this, okay, this is the distribution of the orbits. So this is the distance, and this is the inclination of the orbits due to collision between them mostly. You can imagine that when they formed, they were all in the plane of the ecliptic, okay, and because of collision between them, their inclination increased. And you have different names for them. And this is a summary of, so you cannot read it, okay, in some way, but it's a summary of the different, it is to show that there is a systematic in some way, in the systematic in the composition. And what is important, if I simplify that, okay, each color corresponds to a different kind of chondrites. So far away from the Sun, you know, it's blue here. And blue is the asteroids which correspond to carbonaceous chondrites. So carbonaceous chondrites, their parent body are far from the Sun. Unstatite chondrites, the reduced one, are here, in fact. Most of them are here. This is the violet dashed curve here. So they are very close to the Sun. And ordinary chondrites are in the middle, okay, most of them. We see many asteroids, and we have other indications to consider that each of our many chondrites that we see come from different parent body. Even if we have different parent body which have, I don't know, L composition, and all the L chondrites we see, they come probably from different of these parent body, different parent bodies. We know that from what we call the exposure edge. So for when two objects undergo a collision, fragments are produced. These fragments are small size, and they are exposed to bombardment by the solar wind and by the galactic protons also, and this makes a nuclear reaction. Okay, when they are the penetration of these protons are at most several meters, and of course when they are a big object, these protons do not go inside, and there is no nuclear reaction. If a small object is in the vacuum, it is exposed to these protons, and it is irradiated, and this produced by nuclear reaction some radiogenic isotopes that can be measured after that. And from the amount of radiogenic isotope that you have, if you take into account their decay, you can calculate by during how much time they have been exposed to high energy protons, and this is the exposure edge, and this is considered as giving a measurement of the time when these meteorites, so when it is in the, not on the Earth, it is called the meteoroids, has been produced. And you see that, of course, if all the meteorites were coming from the same collision, were fragments produced by the same collision, they would have the same exposure edge. And it's not the case. And you see that there is a range of exposure edge. This is, for instance, for carbonaceous chondrite from 1 to 100 million years, okay? And these are for E chondrites, and it's the same. Even if there are some edges which appear often, there is a range, okay? And so they are coming from different parent bodies. So I just have ten minutes, okay? I can do 10 minutes, can use 10 minutes. So this is to make the introduction of tomorrow. So then, Okay, so you know what is, how do we make the, we calculate the, want to calculate the composition of the Earth, you know what chondrites are. And so now we begin to enter the real questions. So why is it strange that chondrites have the composition of the Sun? So the question is, in fact, what is the composition of the regions where stars are made, are born, okay? And do they correspond to that? So for that, we are going to go to Orion, okay? So this is Orion. You can see the constellation of Orion. So this night, everybody will be able to see that in the sun, in the sky, if there is no cloud. So this is Orion, okay? So the constellation of Orion with the stars, okay? The belt of Orion and the sword of Orion, which is here. And in fact, they are stars, but even with the naked eye, you can see that this is not a star, okay? These are stars, but this is, you know, this is fuzzy. This is not a star. This is a molecular cloud. And so if I go inside, so this is Hubble telescope image, you will see that in fact, this is not a star, and you will see these very famous images. This is in the optic light, okay, and you see these different colors which correspond to gas, irradiated and ionized, okay, mostly hydrogen and helium, and so this is the, if you blow in, this is what you see. If you look to the same region in X-ray, in optic and in infrared, you will see three different things. In optic, you will see ionized gas. In infrared, you will see dust. Dust is illuminated by the light of the star, so it is heated and it is re-emitting light in a wavelength which is slightly different, so in the infrared. And if you want to look to the star, you have to go to the X-rays, because the X-rays, they will go through the dust and the gas, will not be absorbed, and you will see the X-rays. Okay, so here if you look to that, okay, so this is X-ray, so this is optical, this is the gas, okay? And this is infrared, this is the dust, okay? And this is the X-ray, okay? So you see that you have an association of X-rays emitted by young stars, dust and gas. And these stars are very young, okay? And you can see that because they are very active. You know that there are eruptions on the sun, solar eruption. We discussed that at the beginning. You have convection in the sun. Some of this convection, sometimes they result in solar flares, okay, big eruptions. Here you are going to see these young stars. When a star is made, convection and the accretion of the star is much stronger, and this creates very strong eruptions, stellar flare eruptions. The one you are going to see here, this is 7 days long, okay? The distance to this distance, the biggest ever known solar eruption would not be visible, okay? And here you can see what is going on with the stars, and you look to it and you will see some eruption, solar eruption. This is in X-ray, okay? And you will see it will move. This is 7 days, so they undergo eruption very often, okay? You see the eruptions. So these are big stellar flares. So these stars are very young. So they are forming. The astrophysical models show that the only time in the age of a star where you can produce this kind of eruption is when they are forming. So they are forming stars within dust and gas. So stars form within dust and gas. By observing all these stars, you can classify them and find different kind of objects, okay? And you have different periods you can define, which is, so we will see that tomorrow, but they form from a cloud of gas, which is in falling. So at the beginning, they have a very spherical geometry and you can hardly see the star inside. Then most of the material is forming the disk, which is feeding the star, and the star develops in it. So you begin to see it, and then the envelope has totally disappeared and you only have material in the star and in the disk. And then the disk is vanishing because the gas is consumed by the formation of the star, and part of it is consumed by formation of planets around it. And you can see these different, you can identify these different stage, for instance, by this kind of picture. Okay, if you go here, And if you blow up, okay, one of these, okay, one of these points, you will see these kind of things. And for instance here, this is very simple. Here the star is here, okay, just below my finger. It is emitted light everywhere. There is gas around it. Here you cannot see light emitted because you have a thick disk of dust. The disk is here, seen by the edge. And here there is no disk, but there is still gas going to the star. And this gas, it is illuminated by the star and is ionized, and you see the color. So the star is forming here, and you see the disk. What is the composition of material here? The composition is what you know as the standard abundance distribution of elements. This is shown here. And this is also the composition of the sun. This has been a big discovery in the 50s, made in Chicago, where you are physicists and astrophysicists working in the same laboratory. And they found out that by comparing different stars, they all had more or less the same composition. So they are made of hydrogen and helium. And as I said before, Philippe, if you destroy or not the lithium here, it will not make any change, whatever the element you make, in the other ones. And this is the standard abundance of the elements. And this is from this, when this was found, that physicist who discovered that, immediately when a physicist looks to this distribution, immediately he understands how elements are made. And so that this is explained by different nucleosynthetic processes. So this is the iron peak. So this is the below iron, you nucleosynthetic process elements, all these elements. So during the Big Bang, the primordial nucleosynthesis, you make hydrogen and helium, very small amount of lithium, beryllium, and boron. And after that, all the chemical elements up to iron are made by fusion in star. So in the sun, at 20 million degrees, you burn hydrogen into helium because you have a deficit of mass between 1 helium 4 and 4 hydrogen helium. So this is producing energy. And the deficit of mass is going up to iron. So that when a star is burning hydrogen to helium into its core, it is producing some energy. So this is the star is stabilized between gravitational and expansion. When all the hydrogen in the core is consumed, then the temperature, there is no heat emitted, so the star contracts, so the temperature increases, and then you can reach 150 million degrees and begin to burn helium into carbon. And then you will do all the fusion reaction. You will produce all the other elements up to iron. When the core of the star is iron, the mass to go from iron to nickel, okay, there is no deficit of mass anymore. Okay, the mass of nickel is higher than the mass of iron. And so the nuclear reaction stopped at that time. And so at that time, the star collapsed onto the core. And this is a supernovae, type 2 supernovae. And so this is the reason of the iron peak, okay? It is that fusion reaction terminates at the iron. And so you produce iron. You finish with iron. After that, all the other chemical elements are made by a fission reaction, okay? They are made by, not by fission reaction, excuse me, addition of neutron onto a seed which is iron, okay? At the end, you have iron, and if you add to iron neutrons, okay, you will make all the heavier elements in different process, P, S, or R process that we can perhaps, if we have time tomorrow, this is the topic of the last question tomorrow, okay? And so chemical elements are made by Big Bang nucleosynthesis, stellar burning and up to iron, after that by all the RP process, okay? So the Big Bang is Big Bang nucleosynthesis. Stellar burning, this is during in the star, during the evolution of the star. And all the heavier elements heavier than iron are made during the supernova process. But during the explosion of a supernova, where you have high flux of neutrons which cross the star and which can be added to iron. And so this is a standard composition, okay? This is the composition that you see and you find in each star. And this is the explanation of that is that nucleosynthesis has been working in the galaxy for 12 or 13 billion years. And so it is more or less the same everywhere now. But you can also look to the composition not of the star but of the gas in the interstellar medium between the stars, because this is the material from which you are going to make the star, the gas which is between the star. And this is shown in this diagram, and this is the major problem, one of the major problems to make the chondritic composition. And this is shown in this diagram. Here you have the composition normalized to silicon and normalized to the solar or the standard abundance, so zero and log unit. So zero here would mean that you have this element is in the interstellar medium in the same amount than in the standard abundance. And this is condensation temperature. And you see that only the volatile elements are in the gas, nitrogen and helium, but all the refractory elements are not in the gas. They are not in the interstellar medium in the form of gas. They are in the interstellar medium, but in the form of grains. And this means that all this, the condensation has taken place, and in the interstellar medium you have gas and dust. The dust is formed with refractory grains. Most of the chemical elements are in grains, and only very volatile elements are in the gas. In fact, the gas is only hydrogen, helium. All the chemical elements are in grains, in dust. So when you form the solar system, we have said before that condensation was the major process, that we are condensing a gas of solar composition. But the first problem is to make a gas of solar composition, because we form the sun, the solar system, from a gas which is absolutely not of solar composition. It is containing only hydrogen and helium. And this is complicated. And the other problem, of course, is we are coming back to isotopes. The other major problem is that the isotopic composition of the sun is absolutely not that of chondrites. And this has been found recently by a lot of efforts looking to the oxygen isotopic composition of the sun. You cannot measure the oxygen isotopic composition of the sun by spectroscopy, because the lines of the different isotopes are too closed, so that you cannot measure precisely. You need to have a sample of sun. And the sample of sun is a sample of solar wind, and you have two ways to get it. Either you go to the surface of the moon, you take lunar rocks, they are impregnated by solar wind. So if you take these rocks and you find a way to extract the solar wind and you put it in a mass spectrometer, you can measure the isotopic composition. So there was a lot of effort to do that during 10 years to measure the oxygen, the nitrogen, the carbon, precisely isotopic composition. And the other way is to go to sample directly the solar wind. This was done by a mission named Genesis, which exposed for 2 years collectors to the sun and brought them back to Earth. And this is the result, okay? For instance, for oxygen, you remember this diagram. The Earth is here, chondrites are here, here, and the sun is here, okay? The major element in the sun and in chondrite, oxygen, has not the same isotopic composition in the sun and in chondrite, and it is on the line of slope 1, so this is non-mass dependent fractionation, so this is not the same oxygen here than the oxygen which is here. And so this is a problem. You have to solve also this problem. The moon is like the Earth, yes. Yes. Very close to the Earth. Yeah, of course. This is the solar wind on the moon is the, because its energy is a few MeV, is implanted over 50 nanometers. So it's just the external skin of the grain. But in mass, if you take a rock sample, you measure it, it's the composition of the silicate of the moon. And my last two slides still. So this is the one major problem is that the chondrites are solar in composition, chemical composition, but in isotopic composition, at least for the isotopes we can measure, they are not solar. And another problem is that if you look to chondrites, in fact, they are very complicated objects. We have seen that they contain refractory inclusions, so they contain minerals condensed from a gas, presumably of solar composition, We will check that tomorrow. At very high temperature, they contain the chondrules, okay, which can be made by melting of dust, which could be condensed from the solar gas. But there's also condensed pre-solar material, minerals which were not formed in the solar system. And of course, we know that for this silicon carbide grain, which is a pre-solar grain. If you measure the isotopic composition of this grain, I don't know this one, but it can be silicon carbide, it can be made by only one isotope of carbon and one isotope of silicon. And so the only way to understand that it was condensed in an envelope of a star where the nucleosynthesis of, for instance, carbon 12 was taking place. So it was condensed in a star. This star died, expelled this dust in the interstellar medium, and this was part of the dust which was used to make the solar system. And this dust was not vaporized, because we can find it in a meteorite. Okay, so part of the carbon and the silicon was in this grain, but this grain was not vaporized to make the solar gas, because it's still there. So you can say, okay, this is a detail because it is a very refractory grain, but you have also that. Okay. And this is probably called GEMS, for glass embedded metal sulfides. And what you see here is amorphous silicate composition, so composition which is forsteritic composition or austenite composition, and with sulfides. And the black things you see here are metal blebs. And this is probably what we think is the composition of the interstellar silicates. You will condense in an envelope of a star forsterite, anstatite, metal. They will be agglomerated together. They will be bombarded by galactic cosmic rays, so their crystalline structure will be destroyed, and it will make that. Okay, but this with this amorphous silicate, if you heat it to a few hundred degrees, you will recrystallize it. Okay, you will crystallize this structure, and so this is also pre-solar because of its texture and composition, and also isotopic composition. But we also find that in chondrites. Okay, so this has not been vaporized also, and this is what is containing all the silicon and the magnesium, and part of the oxygen, which is making the solar system. So this is complicated. Okay, you have to find a way to make the solar composition, but not to vaporize everything. And at the end, you make a chondritic composition with components which have very different origin and different composition. And even more, if you look here to this diagram, which is showing you the edge distribution of chondrules of this object, you see that the range of edge is up to 4 million years. So in a chondrite, which at the end has a solar composition, you put objects that it is made by objects that you form over 4 million years. Okay, and so it is very, because the composition of the gas, of the disk, of everything changed during this time, and it's very strange that at the end you have this composition. And so my introduction to tomorrow is that one. Okay, is if you want to make the chondritic composition, the solar system, so you want to, this is a picture of a protoplanetary disk in which you see the black ellipse are regions where you have no gas, because you have probably small planetesimals which are turning around the star. You start from here, the interstellar medium, cloud of dust and gas, and you go through this phase to these stages, the young star, the star is here, the disk is here, the bipolar jets are here. Okay, here you see this, here in this one, you see the star is here, the disk is here, it is illuminated, the gas is around, it is illuminated from above, and you see that, okay? So you go through these different stages. You start from dust and gas in this interstellar medium. At the end, here, you have rocks of chondritic composition, but to go from here to here, okay, it's quite complicated, okay? This gas can be condensed at various temperatures. The dust which is introduced, some of it can be vaporized, will modify the composition of the gas. Some of it will can be preserved and go directly to the dust and make the chondrites. Part of it can be processed, okay, not totally vaporized, and so on. And you have to find a way to make non-mass dependent isotopic variation in it, and this is quite complicated. And I will show you tomorrow. Try to answer to this question and to other ones. Thank you.
Thank you.